as he's working the mic out, we'll just reillustrate Luke 24. It says, but early dawn on the first day of the week, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And while they were puzzling over this, two men in dazzling robes suddenly stood beside them. And while the women remained terrified, bowing their faces to the ground, the men asked them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has been raised. Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinful men, be crucified and raised on the third day. And then the women remembered what Jesus had said and returned from the tomb and reported all things to the 11 disciples and to all the others. Pray with me. Dear God, hide me behind the cross. Take Seth out of the way so that you and you alone will get the glory. And let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Today I want to talk to you from the subject, He has risen. He has risen. We are in a series of teaching of the Articles of Faith, of the Apostles' Creed. And we have talked about the virgin birth and how God chose Mary to be the mother of the Messiah. That lets us know that God can choose ordinary people to do extraordinary things. We talked about Christ, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, him being crucified and him being dying and him being buried. We also looked at the descension into hell. And because he descended, the very thing that we were held captive to, he captured so that you and I could be free. And so this morning, we want to focus on the third day, the day that he got up with all power in his hand. And in the book of Luke, Luke provides for us evidence that Jesus not only died, but that he also has risen. This text, it sets the scene and lets us know that when the women went to the tomb with the spices that they had prepared, they found the stone had been rolled away and the body of Jesus was no longer in the tomb. Instead, they saw two angels dressed in dazzling apparel. And while the women were perplexed and afraid, the angel said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but he has risen. The angels were reminding them that of what Christ had spoke to them. In other words, they were ministering the message of the resurrection. And one of my fondest memories as a child is the memory of being part of our Easter celebration. It brought back memories when she was describing it to the children this morning. Because it's in that celebration that we told the story of Christ. How he suffered, how he bled and died, and how he rose from the dead. And at the end of the celebration, I can remember us saying, "He has risen. He has risen. Praise God, he has risen." And here in our text, we see the angels ministering the message of the resurrection, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, saying that he must be crucified and on the third day rise again, letting them know that Christ is alive. So what then is the resurrection? The resurrection is the foundation of our Christian belief. It is the historical event whereby Jesus came back from physical death to newness of life with a glorified body, never to die again. That is the message. That is the foundation of our faith. The very fact that you and I, as believers of Christ, we believe that Christ is no longer in the grave, but that he has risen. His bodily resurrection, it validates the claim that he is both Lord and Christ. It proves the fact that his life and his death were not just the life and death of a good man, but that he indeed was God incarnate, and that by his death we have forgiveness of sin. That leads me to why he did it. Number one, he did it out of love. Number two, he did it so that we might be justified and forgiven. He did it to fulfill the promise and the prophecy. See, we have to understand that the resurrection is the foundation of Christian belief. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says, "Now I'm making known to you, brothers, the gospel that I proclaimed, which you accepted, on which you have taken your stand, and by which you are also being saved, if you hold firmly to the message I proclaim to you, unless you believe in vain. For I pass on to you the most important parts that I receive. The Messiah died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. He raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and is still alive." Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul is letting the Corinthians know that the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of Christ is the foundation of Christianity. Paul is trying to get them to see that our faith is built on the foundation of the resurrection. Our faith is built on the fact that we as believers believe that Christ has risen. He explains to them that if the foundation is removed, then the whole fabric will fall apart. And if the foundation falls apart, then all of our hope for eternity is lost. In other words, Paul is saying that if Christ is still in the grave, then our preaching is in vain. Our faith is in vain. In verse 17, Paul says that if Christ has not been raised, our faith is worthless and we are still in our sins. But because Christ died and because Christ has risen, then you and I can be forgiven. We can be justified, meaning that we can be made righteous in the eyesight of Christ. So understand that it is by holding firm to this truth that we are made to stand in the day of trials and keep faithful to God. See, the resurrection, it is important to the Christian belief, both historically and doctrinally. In fact, the resurrection is the crowning demonstration of the truth. It is, in fact, the fulfillment of promise and prophecy that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinful men. He must be crucified and rise on the third day. So the next question I raise is, for whom did he fulfill the promise and the prophecy for? Who did he do it for? And the answer is that he did it for all of us. He suffered for all of us. He was crucified for all of us. He died and was buried for all of us. And on the third day, he rose for all of us. The proof is in the text. It says that they found the stone had been rolled away and that the body of Jesus was no longer in the tomb. Verses 3 through 5 says, but when they went in, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were puzzling over this, two men in dazzling robes suddenly stood beside them. And while the women remained terrified, bowing their faces to the ground, the men asked them, why are you looking among the dead for someone who is living? So we now know why he did it. We know who he did it for. And we in fact know that he did indeed rise from the dead. So the question now is, how did he do it? How did he get up? Because we have the evidence that Christ got up. The empty grave is there to prove that he indeed got up. The infallible proof in Scripture of his resurrection provides proof that he did rise from the dead. So how did he do it? I'll tell you how he did it. He did it by his own power. Understand, he got up by his own power, and he got up with all power. One writer writes that Jesus rose with all power in his hand. Does anybody here this morning believe that Jesus rose with all power in his hand? He got up with the power to conquer death. He has the power to forgive our sins. God has the power to heal our aching bodies. He has the power to resurrect himself from the dead. And Luke adds detailed accounts of his resurrection. He gives details of his appearance. On one account, he appears to two disciples on the Emmaus Road, and on this account, he walks with them. He talks with them. He ultimately witnesses to the disciples. And on the second account, when he appears in the midst of the other disciples, he says to them, "Observe my hands. Look at my feet." He sups with them and he eats in their presence, letting them know that this is not an illusion and that you are not hallucinating, but this is in fact the real thing. Letting them know that his body is not a resuscitated body like that of Lazarus. Why? Because Lazarus would have to die again. But Christ, his resurrected body, was a glorious body. Still a physical body, but a transformed and empowered body that would never see death again. And I don't know about you, but I get excited when I know and think about the fact that Christ has risen. It excites me to know that Christ lives. Why? Because I understand that because he lives, you and I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all of our fears are gone. Why? Because I know who holds the future. And life is worth living simply because he lives. He lives, praise God. He lives. And as I get ready to close, let us practice what the children taught us this morning. He has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Verse 8 and 9, it says to us that the women remembered what Jesus had said, and that they returned from the tomb. And they told the disciples and all the others. And my challenge to us today is that now that we have been reminded, let us go and tell someone that Christ has risen. May God bless you, and may heaven smile upon you.